This is one of the most important topics that I have learned about since I became an animal rights activist. It's something that I've learned about from the animals at the sanctuary that I run in Ireland, Eden Farmed Animal Sanctuary. So I've learned it firsthand, and it can't be more factual than when it comes from the animals themselves. Confronting the injustice of human use of other animals is a painful process that involves facing up to a very dark and disturbing side of ourselves. But it's a necessary process if we're to accord them the respect that we owe them. We grow up in a society that denies the reality of animal sentience. And even when this science is accepted, the logical consequences of respecting other animals' rights not to be used as resources fails because of our species' nature. The hypocrisy of what we teach our children is very obvious in this new ad from Go Vegan World, which is live in Brighton at the moment. If any of you are in the public bathrooms in pubs and shopping centres and restaurants, you might see it. It's also at the marina. It illustrates the trusting nature of the animals we use and shows that however humanely we treat them while they're alive, it's morally outrageous to breed them to be killed. In an effort to dilute, distract and deflect from veganism as the only rational solution to what's often referred to as animal cruelty, the animal exploiting industries, and even some who claim to advocate for other animals, proclaim humane use instead. You'll see this on campaigns and labels that refer to terms such as free range, grass fed, outdoor range, outdoor reared or cage free. The notion that we can humanely use the bodies and lives of other animals to meet our desires and needs is a myth and a lie. Humane use is simply not possible, and even if it were possible, using other animals to meet our needs and desires violates their rights. When we refer to humane use or welfare standards, we're using a psychological defense mechanism to distract ourselves from our own pain, the anxiety that we face when we realize that what it costs them when we use them. And it's also a psychological defense mechanism that distracts us from our duty to help to stop using them. Like the UK, Ireland, where Go Vegan World has its headquarters, thrives on its image as an island populated by farm families who lovingly tend to the animals in their care. Animal agriculture is regarded as the backbone of a strong Irish economy, the well-being of which is an essential component of Ireland's aim of feeding the world. This goal of feeding the world involves breeding and killing a growing number of animals every year, despite the ethical, environmental and health arguments against animal use. The label humane and the cry of having the best standards of animal welfare in the world is a tactic used by those who exploit other animals, either as part of their work that they profit from, or those who exploit them simply by not being vegan. And it camouflages the injustice of animal use. There's no acceptable way to use other animals. Every animal bred and used by us is owned by us. They lose their freedom. They're confined and deprived of everything that is natural to them. They are completely under our control, and most of them suffer the horrendous conditions that we keep them in. Every one of them is bred to be killed. There is absolutely nothing humane about any of it. Non-vegans continue to use the word humane as a defence mechanism to justify their actions, as well as a ploy to soothe consumer conscience and ensure the continued demand for their work. Veganism is not a diet. Animal rights are not solely the domain of farmed animals, but because the vast majority of animals who are harmed and killed by us are used for food, most of the efforts of Go Vegan World are devoted to them. All the industries that exploit other animals have reacted very strongly to Go Vegan World, including the vivisection industry. Their defence is rarely that it is acceptable to exploit and kill. Their defence is that scientists and farmers care about the welfare of the animals they profit from, a delusion that sustains them and enables them to continue their work. Our welfare regulations do not make use of the term humane. Instead, they set out in very detailed ways how animals can be used, bred and killed. Under these laws, someone can be prosecuted for causing unnecessary suffering to an animal used by us, but that unnecessary suffering does not include the standard practices, including killing, that are inherent in the industry. Indeed, as long as we are sold the myth that animal use is necessary for humans, virtually anything it takes to get their bodies onto our shops is regarded as excusable. Mutilations and butchering of conscious animals are facts of non-veganism, facts that we need to have the courage to face. It's very easy to fool consumers into believing that what they buy is harmless. In fact, packaging only needs to carry an Irish or a red tractor or an RSPCA label for consumers to feel confident that they're spending their money in an ethical manner. Sometimes they even imagine that they're helping animals by spending their money in this way. Those who profit from them are portrayed as caring for them as affectionately as they would their own children. But scratch beneath the surface, and the reality is quite different. Despite their portrayal as an idyllic place for farmed animals and the people who profit from them as caring animal lovers, Ireland and the UK, along with every country in the world, are terrible places to be if you're not human. For hundreds of years, we have prevaricated on what other animals need from us. Within an animal welfare movement, we have attempted to justify our use of them by comforting ourselves that we look after their basic needs. When another being is bred onto this earth as a resource for us, with a death sentence on her young head, her welfare can never be respected because her very right to freedom, autonomy, and life has been violated. While another living, feeling being is our legal property, her welfare will never matter as much as our need to profit from her. When another being is thought of as an ingredient whose purpose is to serve our needs, her needs will never matter as much as our desires. In an effort to dilute and distract from our obligation to respect their rights, the industry that profits from them, and unfortunately some who advocate for them, promote the idea that if we meet some of their basic needs while they're alive, it's acceptable to breed, own, and control their lives and to kill them. We fool ourselves into believing that keeping them alive until we kill them is caring for them. Their welfare will never matter when they have no rights. Their need for us to respect their right not to be our property. They need us not to be used by them and not to be harmed or killed by us. Go Vegan World began as a very small public education campaign 3 years ago. It was born of my confidence, stemming from my knowledge as a psychologist in the human mind, as well as what I witnessed over the years of doing vegan education, that there are sufficient numbers of people in the general public who believe it's wrong to harm other lives. And when they recognise that other animals are sentient, and when they recognise that when we use them, we harm them unjustly, they'll go vegan. And once a sufficient number of the population, a sufficient percentage of the population goes vegan, we'll begin to see change. And all the other people who are not brave or courageous enough to think about animal rights and think about this as a social justice issue will follow suit. The campaign is not distracted by anything ancillary to what matters, which is that other animals are sentient and have rights. It's easy and practical to be vegan. When we're not vegan, we unnecessarily harm them in violent ways that conflict with our own ethics. The campaign is not distracted by anything other than what matters to other animals. Its most significant success to date has been the finding by the Advertising Standards Authority against the dairy industry and in favour of Go Vegan World, allowing us to label the use of other animals for dairy production as unjust and inhumane, regardless of adherence to welfare practices. For those of you who are not familiar with this finding, I'll just give you some brief background. We ran this ad in the UK Telegraph newspaper in February 2017. It shows this cow behind a barbed wire fence, and it's accompanied by an eyewitness statement of a visit to a dairy and the standard practice that was witnessed in that dairy. Complaints were made to the Advertising Standards Authority by the National Farmers Union, alleging that the claims in the ad could not be substantiated and that they would mislead readers. We substantiated all the claims made in the ad by providing scientific evidence from the dairy industry itself and from peer-reviewed scientific journals. our response demonstrated that far from suggesting that the issue is a failure to comply with welfare regulations, dairy is inherently unjust and inhumane, even under the best standards of care. Based on the evidence provided in our submission, the Advertising Standards Authority ruled in our favour. This is highly significant and unprecedented in animal rights campaigning. Although this finding is confined to the production of dairy rather than to animal use in general, it's the first time that a clear message went out to the public that distinguished between animal welfare and animal rights, the rights of other sentient beings not to be used by us. How did a small sanctuary from Ireland win this right for other animals that's so significant that it made front page news in the UK Times, coverage in all prominent Irish and UK media outlets, as well as media coverage in several countries worldwide? It did so because it's a very simple campaign that tells the truth, one that lets the animals speak for themselves. The campaign is inspired and informed by the residents of Eden who featured in our videos, and they feature in most of our ads. Animals like Emily and Charlotte, who were rescued from human use in the meat industry and taken to live at Eden, where they've given us the opportunity to get to know them as unique individuals who represent the billions of others who live tortured lives and die at our hands every year. This is what makes Go Vegan World a unique campaign. These individuals from Eden, whose names are written on the ads and who represent their comrades, have taken to the streets and confronted us with who they are and what they need from us. They need us to empathise with them so that when we mentally swap places with them, we can glimpse what they experience at our hands and realise the injustice of it. They need us to radically alter how we think and feel about them. They need us to stop believing and living as though we are superior to them, and to stop believing that it's acceptable to breed, exploit and kill them because they're not one of us. When I went vegan 10 years ago, we had none of the conveniences available today. Veganism is very doable without any of the consumer goods that are currently used to advertise it. Not that they're a problem. They're very handy and they're particularly useful for us now in our vegan education to encourage people, but they're not necessary because veganism is not a fad or a commodity that can be bought or sold. It's a non-violent way of living that results because of the deep shock of facing this very dark side of our natures and our history and taking responsibility for ceasing to participate in it. The most important thing that we owe other animals is to learn about and recognise their sentience, that they have physical and emotional feelings, that they are aware of their lives and of themselves in this world. The problem other animals face is not one of animal cruelty or lack of humane treatment or inadequate welfare legislation. It's one of animal use, and it stems from our speciesism. And nothing quite addresses that problem in the way that rational, non-violent vegan education does, simply by discussing these facts with non-vegans, as we all would have wished somebody discussed with us when we were not vegan. Vegans do not use other animals. We don't view them as our property. We don't view them as ingredients or tools or commodities. Being vegan means that we don't believe we're superior to them. We respect them as our equals, and we come to think about them and feel about them in radically different ways to the ways that we inherited in our species' culture. We breed domesticated animals who have been selectively created by humans for human benefits in ways that greatly harm them. We deprive them of the opportunity to be who they are, who they were before we domesticated them. And anybody looking at this chicken rescued from an Irish free-range farm can see that she's a person. I don't need to debate that with you. You can look and recognise that for yourself. The only way to stop participating in her exploitation is to stop using them. Welfare legislation and humane treatment are completely irrelevant to the issue. I took part in a panel here today on welfare legislation, and just before it I said, oh my God, you know, I know nothing about welfare legislation. And then I said to myself, you know, why would I? why would I even waste my time reading about it when it is so irrelevant to what they need from us? Vegans avoid the products and practices that harm other animals, not because they're like us, not because we have underestimated their intelligence, but because they feel. It's because they feel that we're obliged to respect them, and we only begin to do this by being vegan. Every one of us in this womb wants to avoid harm and suffering, and we all want to live our lives in ways that have some purpose and meaning, as well as a sense of peace and some happy, pleasurable experiences. But we don't have a monopoly on these universal needs. Other animals have them too, because we all have this neuropsychological makeup that enables us to feel and be conscious of our lives. Like us, they have sense organs. They have two eyes, two ears, a nose, a mouth. Major organs like hearts, kidneys, liver, and skin. It was when I first looked at the sheep at Eden, and I recognised that they even have eyebrows in common with me, that it suddenly hit me that we're the same, but we look slightly different. They perceive the world through the same senses as us. They see, smell, taste, and touch, and hear. And it's these senses that enable them to interact with the world. Their senses feed information from the world to their brains, where they interpret and make sense of it because they're intelligent. Like us, they are individuals with preferences as to what they like or dislike. Any of you who have ever been at a sanctuary or seen video footage of an animal, vegan animal sanctuary can see this. Anyone who is a companion animal can see this. Like us, they experience emotions like joy, sadness, frustration, and excitement. These are scientifically verified facts. Like us, when they are physically harmed, their sensory nerves send signals to their spinal cords and brains that manifest in the physical feeling of pain and the psychological experience of being in pain. In 2012, an international group of scientists signed the Declaration on Consciousness. It stated that other animals are at least as conscious as humans, that humans are not unique in possessing the neurological substrates that generate consciousness and emotions. Mammals and birds and octopuses also possess these neurological substrates. Animals such as mussels probably possess them, and there's evidence that insects are also sentient. Every child understands this. Every child knows the difference between a real animal and a stuffed toy. This information has been known in the scientific community for a very long time. Veterinary care is built around its acceptance. A large pharmaceutical industry is built around its acceptance. The whole vivisection industry is built around its acceptance. That's why scientists are still replicating Harry Harlow's experiments by rearing a primate without her mother to assess her reaction, the reaction of a vulnerable child to deliberately inflicted terror, in an effort to understand human psychological suffering. This is why they can inflict pain and disease on other animals and assess their response to treatment, because the scientists who torment them accept that they feel and that they have conscious awareness of their own lives. The reason the declaration was made was with the intention of bringing this information that was already well accepted in the scientific field into the public domain. Any logical recognition of sentience demands that we respect the right of other animals not to be used and killed by us. It demands, at the very least, that we live vegan. It's not logical to acknowledge their sentient capacity and their conscious awareness of and interest in their own lives and advocate for humane conditions and better welfare. That just does not make sense. I implore other activists to please keep the focus on animal sentience. That's really all that matters in this fight for animal rights. The non-vegan public need to be reminded of who they're using, that what they call food and clothing and cosmetics are beings who feel just like them. Before I went vegan, I wasn't consciously aware of animal sentience. I was completely unaware of the extent to which other animals' lives matter to them. It was when I began observing animals like Pip in this photograph that I saw how much we had in common, that they can make decisions for themselves, that they have friends and families that they care for. I saw their capacity for pain, but also their capacity for pleasure and the fact that they treasure life. It was when I saw the first rescued lambs at Eden jumping for the sheer joy of it that the words leg of lamb began to jar on my conscience, and it occurred to me that regardless of how well we treat them while they're alive, their lives don't belong to us. They have an interest in staying alive, and eating them and using them is a moral issue. Every animal bred for human use is destined to die in a slaughterhouse, regardless of how they're treated before they die, and regardless of the attractiveness of the label or the monetary value that retailers place on their body parts and secretions. They have the same feelings that we would have if we swapped places with them. None of them go willingly to their deaths. The animal you've just seen, if you've noticed, he had his horns. So it's very unlikely he came from a factory farm. He probably came from one of those, you know, grass-fed, outdoor-reared farms that carry a very high label, a high price for the labels of his flesh. That's also the height of animal welfare, you know, because he went in relatively quickly and was stunned and went down. That's as good as it gets. If this is the price that they pay, why are we supporting it? Why don't we connect with the living, feeling beings behind the products we use? One of the primary reasons that we don't face up to our ethical obligations to them is because we're sold myths by those who profit from them. We're sold the myth that other animals are essential for human health and that human progress, and that it's acceptable, natural and humane to breed them so that we can kill them. We're even sold the myth that breeding them is doing them a favour, that without us, they wouldn't even have a life. Nutritional science states that a 100% plant or vegan diet is healthy and nutritionally adequate for all stages of life, from pregnancy to old age, and that they may provide, and they do provide, health benefits in the prevention and treatment of certain diseases. In 2016, the Oxford Martin study showed that a global switch to veganism could reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 2/3, lead to healthcare-related savings and avoided climate damages of $1.33 trillion, and could save 8 million human lives by the year 2050. The closer people move to a non-violent vegan lifestyle, the more benefits we gain. But due to the power of vested interests, even with this knowledge, many leading figures call for reduced animal use, better adherence to welfare regulations and more efficient and environmentally friendly ways of using other animals instead of the complete abolition of animal use. Of course, reduced animal use is better than continued animal use, but while a reduction in animal use might help our health or the environment, it still views other animals as objects and resources instead of sentient beings with rights. And while better adherence to welfare regulations might alleviate some of the most torturous conditions in which the vast majority of them are kept as they're used in research or for clothing, entertainment or food, the improvements afforded them are relatively meaningless. They serve the main purpose of appeasing the conscience of us as consumers and increasing profit for producers and retailers. By appeasing our conscience, welfare measures have the net result of prolonging the fight for animal rights. I recall a time before I went vegan when I used to buy what I considered to be cruelty-free products like personal care or makeup products that were not tested on other animals, outdoor reared animal flesh, organic milk and free-range or organic eggs. But when you examine it, you know, it doesn't even make rational sense to think that there's any such thing as humane animal use or humane animal eggs, milk or body parts. Non-human animals are used as resources to meet the most frivolous of human desires, from the makeup we use that was tested on them, to the fashion items we wear that were made from their fur or skin, to the flesh, eggs and milk that we eat out of habit, taste and convenience. Other animals are our legal property. We own them. It costs a lot of money, time and effort to look after that. I can tell you, we've about 100 animals at Eden. It takes us all our time to look after them, and a huge amount of land and resources and finances. Anyone who has a companion animal knows how much care they need, especially if they're ill. Anyone who helps out or runs at a sanctuary is left in no doubt that caring even for a small number of animals is a full-time job for several people and takes a huge amount of resources. Do we really believe that those who farm them in their thousands and profit from them are willing to invest anything more than the very basics necessary to keep them alive and productive enough to maximise the profits before they're killed? They're exploited in an economically efficient manner that benefits those who profit from them. How they experience their lives doesn't really come into the equation. They don't matter. They exist to make money. The whole process of animal use is designed to make as much profit as possible with the least amount of input. They're resources. The fact that they're sentient and alive is nothing more than an inconvenience. When I got to know the residents of Eden, I very quickly saw through the myth that I had bought into. In addition to the fact that other animals' lives are not ours to use or own, very few people realise that regardless of the conditions they're kept in, the animals we use are selectively bred and used in a manner that always harms them. Animals used for their flesh are selectively bred to gain as much muscle tissue as possible very quickly to maximise the amount of flesh that can be extracted from their carcasses at the slaughterhouse. This causes problems for them regardless of the conditions in which they live and are kept before they're killed. They suffer joint problems because their muscle tissue is really just too heavy for their bones. The difference in weight between a wild turkey and a turkey bred for her flesh is very considerable. Her weight is not less because she has been reared on a free range or an organic farm. She may have grown a little more slowly, but she's still at very high risk of hip displacement, arthritis and other very painful joint problems, as well as heart disease because of her rapid weight gain. A substantial number of animals arrive at the slaughterhouse with broken bones, and then they're suspended with the weight of their whole bodies from those broken bones. Chickens used for their flesh are often unable to walk at the end of their short 6-week life. Most birds used as food are artificially inseminated because their breasts are selectively bred to be so large to meet our tastes that they can't even mate. Despite what the labels on free-range or supposedly humanely raised animal foods lead us to believe, they're not fair to equally sentient animals. All they do is make us feel more comfortable about doing the wrong thing, so that the cycle of breeding them to kill them to meet our demand continues. Welfare regulation just prolongs animal use and delays the day when we will achieve rights for them. The hens on free-range and organic farms all have brothers who were killed when they were born, and they're the lucky ones. They'll all suffer the effects of overproducing eggs, whether they lived on factory farms or free-range or organic farms. They'll all be slaughtered at 18 months of age, regardless of where they lived, while they were being used for their eggs. Most of the hens who've lived at Eden over the last decade have been rescued from the egg industry. Even when I first went vegan, I didn't understand the terrible injustice of the egg industry, and it's an area where many of us as vegans lack accurate information. The hens at Eden arrive often in a very bad shape. Most of their health issues arise as a result of having been bred to selectively overproduce eggs. if they're very ill when they arrive, we have them x-rayed, and our findings corroborate the veterinary industry finding that ovarian cancer is prevalent in egg-laying hens. In this photograph is Claudia. She lived at Eden for many, many years before she died of cancer of her beak last year. A hen like Claudia will be slaughtered at 18 months, when her lifespan as a wild, free animal in the jungles of Southeast Asia would have been at least 12 years. And this is true regardless of where she lives. She lives on a factory farm or a free range or an organic farm or a lovely orchard in somebody's backyard, or even most of the time on vegan sanctuaries, even though we're now using hormone implants to stop them from laying eggs. And that is the one thing that has prolonged their life and helped to alleviate a lot of the diseases that we see in them. So how is it that we're not aware of the price they pay when we consume eggs? So as part of the humane myth, let's look at how eggs are marketed. The Happy Egg Company sells organic eggs that are endorsed by organisations like the RSPCA, Compassion in World Farming, and they're similar to products that carry high welfare labels such as Lion or Freedom Foods. This is how they're advertised. You'd be forgiven for imagining that the hens live in some kind of sanctuary. In fact, the Happy Egg Company describes their home as five-star accommodation, but the truth couldn't be further from what's portrayed. This is the inside of a Happy Egg farm. These are the hens that the RSPCA assures us are treated humanely. This is the price they pay for us to have something we don't need, that isn't good for us, and that doesn't belong to us. Missy and her friends arrived at Eden last year, victims of the Irish free-range egg industry. And we don't have the right to inflict this on anyone. Most free-range hens never see the outside world. Born in hatcheries and shipped to egg farms when they're very young, without the benefit of their parents to teach them and give them the courage to explore the world, most of them remain indoors, even when the door is open, as trapped in their own fear as they are in the prison of the egg farm. If we believe the myth that we are sold about humane eggs, or if we as activists promote vegetarianism instead of veganism, we're responsible for beings like Missy. And she came from a free-range farm that carried a glossy label that commanded a high price for her eggs, that carried a very different picture to the reality that you see in front of you. Most people imagine that hens naturally lay eggs, but in their natural state, untouched by humans, they're just like any other wild bird, and they only lay one or two clutches a year just for the purpose of hatching their young. The hens that we know have been selectively bred so that they lay an egg almost every day. At Eden, they lay an egg every day unless we give them the implants. This takes a huge toll on their bodies, and it does so regardless of where they live. Some of the experiences that they have as a secondary effect of selective breeding include osteoporosis, broken bones, respiratory illness, infections, lung, liver, crop and heart disease, and cancer. They frequently prolapse from incessant egg laying. And it was when I looked into the faces of those bewildered hens as they prolapsed that I finally understood the injustice of eggs that I had never grasped before. Every one of them had a brother. Males are useless to the egg industry. They're killed by gassing or live mincing at one day old. We place our trust in political leaders who legislate for this barbaric act. What kind of leader legislates for the live maceration of day-old chicks and then sanctions a humanely produced label on the eggs laid by their sisters? Cormac lives at Eden. He was rescued from the dairy industry within hours of his birth. Just an infant, he could barely stand. I remember the bellows of the mother cows as we took him away, and if they could have saved him, and if they could have killed us, they would. Like billions of male calves just like him, he was taken from his mother so that we could have the milk she produced for him. In the same way that there's no such thing as a humane egg, there's no humane milk. We become completely disconnected from the source of what we consume, and we're enabled to do so by advertising. The industry flourishes by keeping people ignorant of its exploitative practices, but the truth is a far cry from the myths they sell us. The truth is one of utter grief, torment, pain, disrespect, exploitation, and death. Female cows, like human women, only lactate following pregnancy. Dairy begins with the extraction of semen from males. Females are then forcibly impregnated using artificial insemination in a highly invasive, often painful procedure. Farmers often train on cows in the slaughterhouse because they're so badly injured by the training procedure that they have to be killed. Like human mammals, a cow has a strong attachment to her calf, but in the dairy industry, their babies are taken from them just after birth so that we can have the milk that she lactates to feed them. Her sons will be killed at birth or soon after for veal or beef. Cows are milked for 7 of their 9-month pregnancy. Any woman who has ever breastfed knows the demands that pregnancy and lactation place on a mother's body. To have them occur simultaneously throughout their short lives, in addition to the fact that they're selectively bred to produce 10 to 15 times more milk than they would naturally require to feed their calves, in addition to the psychological trauma of repeated loss of their calves, results in minds and bodies that are exhausted and broken while they're still very young. Science corroborates that metabolic diseases are prevalent among dairy cows. Evidence from veterinary science and animal behaviour journals also demonstrates that separation of cows and calves causes distress to both, as if we needed that evidence. It makes common sense. In fact, the longer cows are with their calves, the more intense the behavioural indications of their distress after separation. Deprivation of their mothers affects the ability of calves to regulate their emotions and to socialise later in life. Most people think that the animals we use exist for the purpose of our taste and well-being. I know, I used to. People think that chickens just lay eggs and the cows automatically produce milk. They assume that farmers are doing them a favour by relieving them of that milk. In general, members of the public are just like we were before we went vegan. They're not aware that pregnancy, birth, lactation and the separation of mother and cow, mother and calf are essential components of the dairy industry. Few people consider the slaughter inherent in dairy and they don't make any association between the beef and leather industries and dairy products. Like every other animal we use, the rights violations that take place in large dairy factory farms also take place on organic dairy farms. All the animals who are bred onto farms that command higher prices for their so-called humane products end up in the same slaughterhouse as those who live on factory farms. Other animals need us to know what we inflict on them when we're not vegan. It's our right to know, and it's our responsibility to act on that knowledge by refusing to participate in it.
Thank you.
other animals need us to stop thinking about ourselves and to think about them. This is a defenseless child who has never harmed anyone. Regardless of any statement to the contrary by industries who profit from him, our use of him inflicts experiences on him that we would not want to endure ourselves. If you met someone like him, would you think a piece of cheese was worth taking him from his mother? Would you think an ice cream was worth his life? We can never justify this. We can be vegan or we can be violent, but there is no other choice. So we started the talk a little bit late, but I think the next speaker is probably due to come on very soon. So while Ed is setting up, if anybody has any questions, I have about 5 minutes to take them. Any questions from anybody? Okay.